know people and to what? To be known by people. Now, in Avatar, how many of you have seen Avatar with the funny blue people? They're kind of cool. In Avatar, they constantly say this thing, I see you. I see you. And Izzy's talked about this. A number of prophetic people have talked about this before. That is really prophetic. It really is. That is exactly what God wants in his beautiful family of believers. He wants people to say nothing. When I was in Bible college, they used to say all the time, nothing to hide, nothing to prove. I love that. Is my favorite. I love that. Nothing to hide, nothing to prove. Exactly the same. I see you. I can see you. There's a vulnerability. There's a transparency with people that actually comes. And that is when you're truly free. When you are known and you know. When you can say, I see you, and others can say, I see you back. When you know that you are known and that you are knowing others. And this is the last one I put. To make time, this is a concept of belonging as well. It's more of an active, but it says to make space and time to be with others. To make time and space to be with others, because you can belong, but just the practical outworking of that is, what's another definition of belonging? You belong when you actually make time and space to be with people. That's actually a sign that you do belong. Do you understand? When you don't make time and space to be with people, it can be a fruit of not yet continually have connected. And what did I start out with today? Remember I talked about prophetic people. What did I say that they like to do? Like to go away, to isolate and hear the word of the Lord. I said there was nothing wrong with that. But if this is the fruit of belonging, you know, how many of you like it when someone is excited? How many of you ring someone and they're excited to hear your voice on the phone? How many of you have ever been to the airport to pick up someone and you are excited to pick, I can feel it now. Don't you love picking someone up? You just like can't even, I pace, don't I? When I go to pick up one of my friends, I pace up and down the thing because I just can't stand still because I'm so excited to meet with them. And then I always stand at the wrong letter. And I'm like, and then they ring and they're like, yeah, we've been here for an hour. We're outside. You know, it's happened many, many times with us. And so special. But what is it? I know that when it's a person like that, I know that I'm known by them. Because that's my sense of belonging. It has to be someone like that for you to get in that zone. Does that make sense? How many of you would love to be in that place every time you come to church? Oh, I can't wait. I just can't wait. I can't wait to see Ryan Carr because he knows me. I can't wait. I just can't wait to go and say, Ryan, I had the best week I've ever had. And he'll go, yeah, Daryl. I'm excited. I'm pumped. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? That is the fruit and substance of belonging. You hear what I'm trying to say? And so it's really interesting. People are a pleasure, not a chore. Okay, it's good. Okay, reasons many people, this is going to be a real crowd pleaser this bit. Reasons many people struggle to belong, and this is cool for prophetic people, so I want you to read this very carefully. A sensitivity can create emotional protectors when not nurtured at a young age. This is a really, really big deal. Now, because we're still learning what it is for sensitive people, kids see a lot and they're very sensitive, right? What happens is when kids are young and when people are younger and they're sensitive and they don't know or their parents don't know or anyway, it's no one to blame. We're not going there. I can't believe you didn't nurture my prophetic gift and now I'm destroyed, you know. Don't no one ring your parents and say that. That's not okay. But it's really good to know yourself and it's really good to know your wiring. And then when you see your wiring, you can look through your reactions to people and things that have happened in the past and you actually start to get to know what that could have done to you specifically. So reasons that many people struggle to belong, one of the reasons is that the sensitivity, and I'm going to go into this a bit more, but in a nutshell, as an umbrella, it's all about we lose the ability to be able to trust people. Because what happens is the more sensitive you are, the quicker it is, with that, if you haven't been healed in a particular area, the quicker and more easily it is, the more easy it is for you to trigger off somebody. You know what I'm saying? So someone comes up and they in a place of leadership or a father in the house comes over and they say, hey, you know what, you shouldn't have dropped that packet of chips on the floor. Come on, pick them up, you know. Then suddenly you're like, I can't believe he said that. I'm never going back to that church again. I can't believe it. He told me, it's just like my father. And you're like, whoa, okay. Wow. Well, is that the pastor that asked you to pick the chips up, or is that your dad? Hear what I'm trying to say. Now, what we're beginning to learn is that there are far more prophetic and sensitive people than we actually realized. That's what's actually happening. I'm sitting with people over and over and over and over again, and God's saying, they're a prophetic person. Just ask them four questions. So I just asked them a couple of questions, real easy ones. How often do you dream? Oh, I dream all the time. Wow. How do you feel when you go next to someone that's depressed? Yeah, I start to get all depressed. And, you know, just a couple of real easy questions. I go, I actually think you're quite sensitive. Oh, wow, do you think so? You know, and so it's kind of helping people connect in that. So one of the reasons people struggle to belong is because they are sensitive and they pick things up and they don't necessarily know that they are. So that's a really big deal. Second one is settling. I told you you'd like this. And I am super sensitive. As for a guy, I'm like, Belinda looks at me funny. I'm like, I can't believe you said that, thought that, did that. And I'm normally wrong with her. So, okay, just being honest. Okay, settling often is subject to feeling. Settling is, and so what we do is the word of the Lord says that God sets the lonely in families and in local church. But because we don't feel right, we negate what the word says and we say, no, I'm not feeling it. And so we actually negate. So what we do is things become subject to our feelings. Really big deal. I told you this is very good for sensitive people. So that you go in a place and go, oh, I'm really not feeling this place. It's kind of a bit weird. Well, the reality is I did this for years. I'd go into a place and go, no, don't like the spirit there, not eating there. Well, I can tell you right now, what if God, now I don't do that as much at all. What if God said to me, go into that thing. Can you feel that weird spirit? And I go, yeah, you're there to change that. It's called maturity, isn't it? You just start to mature and you start to realize you are ahead and not, you're above and not beneath. So it doesn't matter what area you go into. What does it matter? No, that shop's got witchcraft in it. Awesome. Let's go in. Let's go and chat to some people. Gosh, we've got guys that like Will Hart that go into the temples, the Hindu ashrams, and go and lead the main guys to the Lord in the middle of the ashram. So praise God. Okay. Same kind of concept. I'm not going to go too much into these, but you can take them home and read them. Bad natural parenting, same concept. You get abused by someone. Hurt by the church. Bad management of prophetic gifts by leaders lead to cycles of rejection. I saw something that isn't God. Okay, I'm weird. I'm leaving the church kind of thing. Orphan mindsets create a drive and fight for ministry and competition between people. This is an extremely big one. There is so much competition and performance in the church, in general, not in this church, as a whole, because people don't have their identity rooted in Christ. Because they don't have their identity rooted, everything has to be, and I'm not saying it's for anyone here, obviously we've all passed this zone, but what I'm saying is that what does happen is that we give a prophetic word and then we hope that someone saw that we gave that prophetic word, because actually our predominant goal, not that necessarily that all of our motive is to not do that, but our motive in the end is for someone to have recognized that, for us to get promoted from our gifting. And that's a really, really big deal too, because it's the Lord who promotes. So if you open doors yourself, it says, as high of you as you have made your nest as the eagles, so from that height you will fall. So what happens, and I had that word specifically over a prophetic meeting that I started 7 years ago. So I started a prophetic meeting a number of years ago. No accountability, nothing. Pulled every prophetic person I knew out of all the local churches, bad-mouthed all the local churches. It's 100% true in front of everyone. And I thought God was going to kill me. I was actually in a situation where we were doing the prophetic things, and I was like, I'm sending out my prophetic words now. I'm Prophet Daryl. This is 100% true. And I literally felt the concaving of my chest in the room as the presence of God fell in the room. No one else did. They were all absolutely fine. And I felt I said, God, you're going to kill me. Like, I just literally felt like you could do that and I would have died. I hid behind a curtain, still didn't go away. I was standing behind the... and from that week, the whole thing fell. And he says, I'm teaching you about family. And I'm going to talk about that in a second as well, because it's really important. But I just want to get through this. So identifying gifts. Being received, your perception is everything. So if you go into a place and you go, okay, do you know, okay, everyone, I've arrived, I've got my prophetic gift. This isn't for anyone here, this is for us because we're mature, we're teaching people this stuff, right? So we're going into a zone and we're going, oh yeah, can you see my prophetic gifting? Are you ready? Are you really ready for this? And then the people don't receive you. They're like, hey, and you're just reeling off all the gift, you're reeling off all the encounters, and the person seems completely disinterested. Well, that's a good place for you to be. You should actually probably stay in that church because they're probably more interested in where your heart's at and how life's going than what you're seeing. Do you understand what I'm saying? Because people always see. It's really important that we don't go, okay, I've seen this and this is really, and now I've got to be, like, people will see, my little children see. I talk to the kids and I see the angels that work with the kids and I go, tell me about the dreams you have. And they go, oh, I can't believe it. You know, the little kids, they go, I dream this dream. And I watch, sometimes the Lord will take me into their encounters and I'll see the angels just drip feeding them dreams at night. I'm like, that's amazing, you know. And they're kids and they don't, like, they're, yeah, I saw 10 angels this morning. It was really good, you know. So it's really interesting. So it's really cool. Listen, so we're all getting activated. Okay, why do we, and so let me, I want to tell you about a vision. When I first came here, because I want to be vulnerable because I think it's really important in this context. When I first came to Jubilee, I had already started out my own ministry. I had my own logo. I'd already started. It was called DCM Ministries. It was an evangelism ministry. I'd already gone to the flight center, booked tickets to India. I had the guy's PO box number. I was just going to wait there until he came. Because this is true. Because I really, did I hear from God? Absolutely. I heard strongly. But I took all the prophetic words that he gave me and I stewarded them all into a now and didn't have any other prophetic counsel that could give me timing. And so, here's a good word. So what happened was that I did all this stuff and I was ready to launch and ready to do this thing, started this prophetic meeting, everything. Nothing seemed to go. I was waiting for all the money. I went to my letterboxes all the time and said, oh God, you said that I'm ready for this ministry. There's no launch. What's that? This is a number of years ago. You're all safe if you're in this house. I'm a lot better now. And so... And I suddenly, it took me a while, but then basically I came here, I was in Jubilee, and we used to have prayer meetings in the, and there's a point to this story, we used to have prayer meetings in the hall there, and it used to be all dusty, and there was a guy who used to come and just pull his guitar, his piano up, and he'd do these prayer meetings, and I just remember lying on my face in one of the prayer meetings in there, and I was just crying out, and I tried to book my ticket to Canada. I'd been accepted on an internship. The Lord said, you can't do it. And it was all this stuff, and I'm like, I've got to go and change the nations and do crusades and do all this stuff. And I was on this, in the floor, and the Lord took me into a vision. Some of you might have heard this, very, very powerful. And he took me into a vision, and I walked down to the end of a dead-end road, and I was down at the bottom of a dead-end road, and there was lots of cobbles on the floor, lots of cobbles and stones on the end of a, you know, a dead end. It's just all gravel. And I'm standing there and I'm kicking the gravel, just kicking it and just standing there and going, this is crap, you know. What a crap. You've taken me to the dead end. And I said, God, and I really had felt the Lord say, stay at Jubilee. And so I said, I can't believe you. And I said, God, and I was standing in the vision. I said, what does the dead end represent? And the Lord smiled and he said, the dead end represents Jubilee, Daryl. And I was like standing here with all this gravel, a dead end. And I was like, well, thanks a lot. Kill me now. Just kill me. Like, how many people have been there? I'm just over it. I've been waiting for a number of years for something. And I just said, that's it. Okay, I'll give up. And you know, you don't really give up. You just say you give up to see if you can sway the Lord a bit. all been there before. Fun being a human, right? So... manipulation didn't work, so I stood there, and the Lord spoke to me so clearly, and he said, Daryl, you've missed it. And I said, missed what? And he said, look closely at the floor. And as I looked closely at the gravel on the floor, all of the stones became the most brilliant, priceless gems, all multicolored. I was standing in all of these gems, and I can feel the tingling. And so what happened was that the gems, as I looked at the floor, the gems encircled me completely around 360 degrees, and then the gems grew really, really quickly up to about 5 or 6 feet around me, and then each of the gems flipped and became a person from Jubilee, and they were all encircled. I was completely encircled with Jubilee, and he said, I'm teaching you about family. I'm teaching you about family. And so, this is why I can bring this word legitimately, because it's important, because I've walked it. And so I'm in this scene, and I'm like, oh, gosh, I can't believe it. And I realized that I wasn't seeing. I'd been here for a number, but I was still waiting to go, still waiting for the next thing. And God was saying, it's not just about, and then I understood that even when he said, I'm teaching about family, that was the language that I knew at that time. But what he was really saying was, Daryl, I set the lonely into family. I set the lonely, the isolated into family, and that's really, really important. And so it was a really big deal for me. And, okay, so... In that, I want to say this. This is really cool. I had a long time in my life where I didn't settle at all. I didn't settle at all. And I just moved from pillar to post, pillar to post, pillar to post. And there is a lot of prophetic people in the body of Christ. And I'll just be honest, there are a lot of people that don't settle. They don't settle. There's stuff that takes them away from settling. And I'm going to play a little, I just want to play a clip. And when I was a little kid, I grew up where my mum wasn't very nurturing. And so I was released from my home at 14. And what that meant was I was allowed to go anywhere I wanted to do. And my friends and my friends' parents gave me a nickname from a TV show that we used to watch when we were little kids. And I want to play that. We've played it once before, but I want to play that and then I want to get back into it. Danny, if you can do it. And I want you to listen to the words. It's the words that's really important here. So try to listen to the words.
There's a voice that keeps on calling me. Down the road, that's where I'll always be. Every stop I make, I make a new friend. Can't stay for long, just turn around and I'm gone again. Maybe tomorrow I'll wanna settle down. Until tomorrow, I'll just keep moving on. So if you wanna join me for a while, just grab your hat, we'll travel like that's old style. Maybe tomorrow I'll wanna settle down. Until tomorrow, I'll just keep moving on.
There you go. It's actually really moving because that was literally, I actually admired that dog for many years because I liked his style. That's funny. Why did I show you that? The spirit of the hobo, the word hobo literally means one without home. One without home. And God is eradicating the spirit of homelessness in the body where people aren't able to settle. God, so strong, huh? People, I can feel presence on that, so strong. This is honestly what I feel like the Lord is doing. When prophetic people are very, very good at jumping and moving and settling and moving and settling and moving and settling. And what happens when it gets to the point where the I see you happens, it's too challenging and people leave. It's when people really, really start to get to know you, not your gifting, but who you are, that you want to up and leave. And this is a really, really big deal because the spirit of adoption released through the family of God is the thing that eradicates this. And this isn't a rebuking word. This is a connecting, prophetic connecting word that when people come in, they actually get healed. And then they don't want to get up and keep moving on and keep moving on. And until tomorrow, I'll just keep moving on and moving on. And that's what happened when I first came to Jubilee. I was still in under the influence of that spirit. I'll just keep moving on. Where's the next step? I was a completely genuine person. I didn't lie or anything like that. Completely genuine. But I didn't want to settle. Just needed to move. Just need to go to the nations. Well, how many of you know that for somebody who likes to just move on, who has a homeless DNA, how many of you know that a word, you're just going to go to the nations, will speak very strongly to them? Yeah, I will. Gosh, I knew I wasn't supposed to be settled in church. It's really interesting. I'm glad you guys are all... Is everyone okay? No one's... Okay, cool. Okay, so why do we need community within the context of the prophetic? Number one, we need one another. We actually need to be connected to the body. Paul talks, I'm not going to read this, but he says, the body is not one member, but many. How can the hand say, I'm not part of the body for this reason, any lesser part of a body? So you know that you're actually part of the body. Number two, this is why do we need community within the context of the prophetic? Number two, we only see in part. The things that you see in the prophetic are only part. They aren't the full picture because the Bible says they're not. Which is a really big deal. So you might have the biggest word you've ever seen, but when you link up with a prophetic company, you realize that you've seen a part and then someone else has seen a part, and then you start to get a fuller picture, which is one of the reasons that many prophetic people, and I'm not bad-mouthing people, but I'm saying that's one of the reasons that people shoot off out of context because they never get the timing on anything. So what happens is they get all the prophetic words, but in community, they've only seen a part. So what happens in community, they get the confirmations And they get the grounding out of the word specifically in a place of accountability. And as a result of that, they're then actually starting to line up to the word that God is speaking to them. And so it says this, now our knowledge is partial and incomplete, and even the gift of prophecy reveals only part of the picture. And I didn't put the reference in for that, but that's in Corinthians in the NLT. And so another reason is accountability. Chris Vallotton says accountability is simply someone holding you to an account for your ability in God. Isn't that a nice way of looking at it? Someone holding, you can't do that by yourself. Another reason, in accountability, it says, let two or more prophets speak, and then others should weigh carefully what they say. That is awesome. So, so cool. So we get all this stuff, and you can have 1,000 words, and I've done this many times, so I'm not saying this from somebody who hasn't done it, but you can have 1,000 words, but what the protocol for those words is then I come and sit in a company of prophets, and then I allow them to weigh my word. And that's a really big deal. I've been privileged to be able to send words. I'm in communication with people on prophetic councils, and I send words. But every time you send a word, you always preempt it by saying, please, can this be weighed? Isn't that awesome? So it's never, you never, ever presume that something is going to be released publicly. You always say, this is for the weighing of the prophets. And then after it's been weighed, it's then sent out. Which is really, really cool, which is why we need prophetic councils. That's so cool. And so another one, it says, you can all prophesy one by one to be encouraged, and the spirit of the prophets is subject to the prophets. The same thing. There's no time you ever receive a word is not subject to the prophets, ever. Ever, ever, ever. Unless God speaks to you something like Mary, that it says was treasured in her heart, but get this, there were also prophets that were confirming what she had had. Do you understand? So even in the most amazing word from God that you're ready, I'm ready because God said that I am going to do this, but I'm never going to tell anyone. Well, even that word is subject to prophets. Because without the in, with allow, now I'm not saying that you let anyone in and you throw your pearls to pigs. That's ridiculous. I'm not saying that at all. But what you do need to do, or what we do need to do, is we need to be vulnerable enough with at least one or two people with the biggest words that we're holding and say, can you see, do you feel like this could be? And I get the privilege of meeting with some people sometimes, and they'll sit down and say, this is the biggest word that I ever got. Will you process it with me? And I'm like, that is maturity. Gosh. And courage. Because imagine if someone said, actually, you know what? I'm actually not, you know. And it's fair, because I've had words before. I'm saying, yeah, yeah, yeah. And you go through journeys, and I have been in an eldership team, prophetic eldership team, for a number of years, 6 years. And I'm in this place where I'm processing stuff, and I'm like going, yeah, I'm feeling this. And then the team have gone, no, that's not the Lord. And I'm like, oh, okay. Hold on, let me go back again. And then my pride just goes, oh, gosh, God, I thought I got it. I thought I was really accurate. And he goes, Daryl, it's still about identity, isn't it? And I'm like, okay, let's go back to the start again. So for growth and maturity, the reason that we need to be in prophetic community is for your growth and for your maturity, being planted in the house that will flourish, really important. Iron sharpens iron, so you get around prophetic people, you get sharpened. And he gave the apostles and prophets, evangelists, shepherds and teachers for the equipping of the saints for the work of the ministry. What are we doing right now? What am I doing? I'm a prophetic equipper. It's one of the things I do. So I'm prophetically equipping people to be able to understand the things of the Spirit, which is really, really important. Because that's what Paul did. Paul equipped. The whole Bible is equipping. The whole Bible is protocol. No, 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 God didn't like protocol. The whole Bible is protocol. Do this, don't do that, do it this way. That's very special, a very, very special ringtone. Now, so Ephesians 4:11 talks about that. And this is, I'm not going to end on this. I'm going to jump into something else and maybe do some questions and answers. But I wanted to try to get through this stuff. And lastly, for our safety and protection, the reason we need to be in prophetic community, because the enemy prowls around like a roaring lion, it says, looking for someone to devour. When a lion goes after a pack, who does he devour? Those who are on the outside. How can he get the ones in the middle? And so that doesn't mean, oh gosh, it just means that it's a really interesting, the isolated doe or deer is a real target for the prey, you know. So it's really interesting. And this is really cool as well. And this is my favorite one. This is what I want to talk about, and this is what I want to kind of frame up right now. And if you love it, you're very wise. And if you don't, bless you. Listen to this. Pride comes before destruction and an arrogant spirit before a fall. Pride comes before destruction and an arrogant spirit before a fall. Another reason that we need to be in prophetic community is so we don't fall subject to pride. And I think, honestly, in the prophetic, this is probably the biggest one. Apart from isolating, we can deal with isolating people. God will lead people, you know. But pride is probably one of the biggest ones. When, if you meet any prophetic minister, I remember I was doing a Mind Body Spirit Festival once, and there was a really, really amazing prophet that we were working with. And I spoke to him in the line. I've mentioned this before, and I'm in the line with him. And we're just about to do prophetic stuff. And I said, oh, you know, I just completely honored him. I really love this guy. And I said, I love your prophetic gifting so much. I just love the way you administrate. No flattery. I was just being completely honest with him. And he said to me, Daryl, that's so encouraging. Thank you so much. People want to hear about the gifting, but they never want to hear about the 10 years in the desert. Yeah. And that is the place of humbling. And I thought, oh, gosh, God, that's it, isn't it? Humble yourself, therefore, under what? Under God's mighty hand, that he might lift you up in due time. Okay, so it's really cool. I went through seasons where I thought I had no pride and that it had all been burnt. I used to get on my knees and say, God, burn all my pride. I stopped praying it because it was so intense. I just say, God, take all my pride away. Burn it all now. Just get rid of it. I don't want any of it. I don't care what it looks like. Just get rid of this, any pride that I've got. And then I'd be like, this is so true. And then I'd be in a meeting and God would give me an opportunity, not now, but in the past, God would give me an opportunity. I'd get the mic and I'd do something reasonably accurate and I would go down and I would, my first thought would be to connect with someone that could have promoted me. And I would go over and say, hey, did you see that? How amazing, like, not how amazing was that word, but there would be something similar. It was like, hey, I got this person's first name or whatever. And I would, and I remember just one of my parents in the Lord would just look at me and just go, love. And I go, oh, no, again. And I just knew it. And I'd go home and just, I was so upset, wasn't I? Many times, Belinda. And I'd just go home again. I go, still not there. Still not there. It's still, there's still a residue there. Now, that doesn't mean you're ever going to get it all together. I'm not trying to say that. But it's really interesting because it says pride comes before what? Destruction or a fall. So is it God's pleasure to not give me any kind of, any influence or metron? No, not at all. It's for my protection. Because the more platform I get, if there's anything existing in my heart, what happens? The enemy's just going to take me out. What does it say about old evangelists? And I'm not prophesying this over anyone or over, but what does it say? They say girls, gold, and glory. They're the three things. Either a moral failing, financial failing, or taking all the glory for themselves. Isn't that interesting? You guys have heard that before, right? And so it's really interesting. Does anyone have that here? No, not at all. But it's really, really interesting. So why am I talking about that? Because I feel like we're in a season, and I'm kind of just going to open up. There's a lot here tonight, so you're just drinking quite a lot. I feel like we're in a time of interdependence versus independence. And interdependence is on the rise, and independence is on the decrease. So the people who are independent, it's going to be so much more easy for us to feel if someone's connected or not connected. And the answer is not to say, wow, you really need to get connected. It is sometimes. If you're a pastor, you can. It's okay to, but do you understand? Like, but it goes with levels of influence. But sometimes it's just going, hey, you know what? Can I take you out for lunch? And it's actually an eradication. It's actually part of this multi-pronged attack that God's got to eradicate independence out of the body again for the protection of the body. Because he loves everybody. It's not like he's going, oh, I can't believe you did that. I'm so ashamed of you. God's not like that at all. He just sees what the end outcome is and he goes, I want this person to come into the fullness of their destiny just as much as I want you to come in the fullness of your destiny. Vice versa, you know, it's exactly the same. So Bill Johnson speaks about the new wine being in the cluster of grapes. The new wine being not in the single grape, but in the cluster of grapes. And that's that I really believe speaks of community. Very, very cool. And I spoke about this before, but from superstar to superstars, God is eradicating isolation and the one man show out of the body. Because it says, and all can prophesy. And all. And that doesn't mean that God doesn't anoint people for that. I really mean it. Of course he does. He'll always use a man. He'll always use a woman. But it's when I went, I talk about this a lot because it really impacted me. When I was overseas and they were doing the crusades, one of the things that really deeply impacted me with the guys that we were with was that none of them hungered for platform at all. Zero. And then I was at the table and I just remember speaking at the table, and I've shared this, it was quite vulnerable, but I want to share it with you. And I literally felt that when I spoke, it was like, I don't even want to talk right now. I just don't even feel like I want to talk. And I said, what is that? And he said, you're experiencing the purity of motive, the purity of motive at the table. And I was like, oh my goodness, the purity. I'm very vulnerable with you guys. Purity, I'm a lot better now. But do you understand? It's a journey. So I'm experiencing the purity of motive. I don't want to talk because people are preferring one another. These crusades cost absolute fortune. And they're still saying, don't care who's on the platform. Don't care who's on the platform. We'll just pray. I'll just sit down there. And I'm talking about big men and women of God and saying, don't care who's on the platform. Let's just win these souls. Really, that is the mentality. I love that. I'm like, oh gosh, that's what's coming into the body. Do you know what I mean? Oh, you know, I'm feeling a bit tired. No problem, I got it. Do you want to get it? Yeah, no problem. You know, and being part of the team here at Jubilee is very similar to that. Finn and Izzy are very like that. You know, they're going, who wants to run tonight? Who wants to run this? You know, and it's very non-platform based, and that's really, really important. You know, I'm just talking about where the motive and the heart. Okay, and I want to talk now about this, which is really cool. I'll just read this. Danny Silk says, you have to work hard for God not to put you in a family. That's what Danny Silk says. And Danny Silk is just basically like God when he speaks. So I'm just joking. But he is. Very cool. Okay. Now, this is totally cool. And I haven't got a clip from it because I don't want to... Is everyone okay? Just breathe. Say I'm okay. I'm belonging. It's a season of belonging for me. This is for me. I feel like it's a real timely word for many people. Okay. I was in worship one time. Please don't take this and post all this stuff on Facebook, by the way, if you can help it, just because I do want to write about it. But it's already out now. Listen, I was in worship one time, and the Lord spoke to a girl, and a girl came over to me, and she said, Daryl, I've got a word for you. And I said, oh, cool, awesome. I haven't had a word for a long time. And I was standing up here, and she goes, yeah, I just got the name Lightning McQueen. And then she looked at me really, really, like, off, and she was like, I have no idea what that is, and walked off. And I was like, I know what that is. That's the little red spot. She had no idea. And she was a very genuine person, so she said she didn't know. She definitely didn't know. And the Lord spoke to me, and he said, I want you to watch the movie Cars. I want you to watch the movie Cars. I said, okay, I'm going to watch the movie Cars. Now, the movie Cars is one of the most prophetic movies in this season of Body of Christ. 100% true. I'm mentoring three people. I told them all to, or one of the three. So, the movie Cars, I believe God is using in this time and will use in this time through many people. I'm not going to go into it. It's not like everyone's going to go, yes, the movie Cars. I'm not exaggerating it, a point. But what I am saying is it's the concept. Disney catches many different concepts, and God uses it to instill kingdom values in children. How many of you know that that's true? 100% true. It's really important. So then I went home, and God spoke to me at the movie Cars, and I was completely dumbstruck with the... And it wasn't like, you know, sometimes you're watching a movie, and you're trying to find... Someone goes, yeah, you should watch this movie, it's really prophetic. Then you go home, and you're like, yeah, it's prophetic. You're trying to find this prophetic significance in it. You're like, yeah, it was really prophetic. Well, I cried watching it. I didn't have to look for the prophetic significance at all. Within the first thing that came on, I was like, I get it. I totally understood already what God was talking about. And I'm going to explain to you, I want to talk to you about the movie itself, because I think that it carries quite a lot for what we're talking about tonight in the belonging in a prophetic community. Now, how many of you have seen the movie? Please say a lot of you. Great. What's the star of the movie called? Lightning McQueen. And what is he? Racing car. And what happens in the movie? Can anyone remember what happens? He gets lost out of his truck, and he is forced into a little community. Is this true? Yeah. He's forced into a little community where there's no sports cars, where they don't even know who he is. And what does he have to do? He has to make a road. And what happens while he's making the road? He falls in love with what? He falls in love with a Porsche. He does, which is always nice. I fell in love with the Porsche too, and my wife. So one day, Daryl, one day. And falls in love. But what happens is that his heart connects. It disconnects from his vision and connects into community. This is really, really, really powerful. And so he's in this situation where he's making the road, and he's making this road, and then he realizes that one of the cars that's hanging out there is actually a super, super famous race car from the past, who everyone knows but is very happy just kind of hanging out, doing his thing in a place called Radiator Springs, right? So he's doing. So he actually gets mentored by a supreme racer while he's in this place. He connects and does whatever else, and he learns to do different turns and everything else. Now, that's great, yeah, awesome. Now, what happens is that at the end of the movie, or towards the end of the movie, Lightning McQueen goes, gets the opportunity. They release him from doing his time, and he goes back to the racetrack, and he starts to race around. I really encourage you guys to watch this movie again. And he goes around the racetrack, and as he's racing, he doesn't have flashes of glory as he did of him winning, because he used to just have these flashes of him winning. He keeps on having the flashes of the family. He keeps on having the flashes of the family of Radiator Springs. Is this true? Have you guys seen this? 100% true. I know, because I watched it this afternoon. And so, again, for probably the ninth time, just to make sure I was... Not the whole thing. So he does that. So he does the race. Then, this is the clincher. His family arrive at the track and become his pit team and champion him into the fullness of the thing that he's called to do, and he wins the cup. But this is even more amazing. This is the most amazing part of it all. How many of you remember the little cars that then help do his wheels? And do you remember what these little cars say all the way through the movie? All they wanted to do was what? They wanted to change the wheels of race cars at the tracks. When Lightning came in and connected his family, the family came into the fullness of their dreams and desires too. Every member of that family ends up supporting him but doing the thing that they were called to do as well. It's an extremely powerful movie. And so what is it all about? It's all about pride being transitioned to a place of humility and community, isolation and independence to interdependence and connection and relationship. That's what the whole movie is about. And that is what God's on with the prophetic communities at the moment. He's bringing those who are isolated down into a place where they're able to connect with community, and those communities are becoming pit teams for one another, so that we can all run the race with perseverance, and we can all finish the race that we've been called to. And if you were here for Patricia King, what did Patricia King talk about? She talked about loving someone else so that they can win their race. Do you remember that? God is giving us a revelation at this time that it's all not all about our race, but it's all about other people's races. And that is the underlying theme of this whole thing. That as prophetic people, it's about us being able to lay down what God is calling us to do. Not forever. Not it's ridiculous, you know, just do that forever. But laying down our gifting to see someone else prosper, to see someone else flourish, and to see someone else come into the fullness of their destiny. How many of you have got kids here? I don't have any kids. But you got kids, right? What would you do to see those kids come into the fullness of what? Anything. Would you lay everything down? Everything. Would you even do one? If God said they'll come into everything if you don't do one thing that you're called to ever again, would you do it? Wouldn't even consider it, right? Wouldn't even consider it. That's what God is calling us to do in the body. And as we bless other people, the fullness of what we're called to will come forth as well. It says think of others. Don't think of yourself more highly than you ought, but it says think of others more, Philippians 2, than you... I've forgotten the... Anyway, I do read the Bible. And so, Belle, can you just get my water? Is that cool? It's just lovely. So, everyone's going to go and watch Cars. Everyone's going to get a revelation. And this isn't just because we're all mature here. Everyone's very mature. This is not about just us getting it. It's about us catching a revelation and then bringing everyone else into that revelation too. Because gone are the days of the superstar, and here are the days of the superstars. And imagine if you had amazing encounter, amazing prophetic experience, and you're sitting with someone and going, and you have such a sense of belonging that you're sitting with someone and you go, oh, I've got this encounter. But gosh, I love them. I wonder what God's been saying to them. Hey, what's God been saying to you recently? Gosh, and then you give them space. Oh my goodness, how beautiful is that? And then they say, wow, thank you so much for giving me that space. And then God gives you opportunity to then share something else on a different level, because everything's a matter of the heart, and God's all really, really concerned about her heart. So anyway, it's good, isn't it? It's a good belonging in a prophetic community. I feel like there's a lot more there's a lot more to that teaching. Like, that's just a taste of it. It's a good taste, though. So an eagle is incomplete without feet. Keep in a place where you are isolating to spend time with the Lord, but just know that you've got to work hard for God not to put you in a family. Is that good? Awesome. So that's the teaching. So bless you. Awesome. Not yet. Cool. So I want to just open up for questions and answers for a few minutes, and then we're going to take an offering, and then we're going to go next door. So any question goes. So just say, if you have a question, please ask. And if I can answer it, I will. And if not, then that's fine. I don't feel obligated to ask one either. Like, only if you really want to ask one. So when I said connected, do I mean serving in the church and being planted? The mindset, and this is not about you, just in general, it's a great question though. Absolutely yes, I believe that that's a certain, totally a part of it. But it's the mindset of serving in the church that has lent itself to a weird kind of zone, and it's not healthy. Does that mean that you should go and do whatever you want to do in your local church? No, I don't believe that at all. When I'm at home, Belinda asks me to do stuff a lot, is this true, that I don't want to do. In fact, 30% of the stuff that she asks me to do, I don't genuinely have joy to do it. Does that make me a bad husband? No. It just means, who likes taking out the trash when it leaks on your pants? No, really. And then leaks on the floor, and then you have to wipe it off. You wipe it off. You all know where I'm at, right? Because someone put a coffee cup in it with the extra coffee in it. And then you're wiping it. You just put your pants on. You're just like... And then it goes on the wall, and you've just had your wall painted, and then you've got a coffee stain on the wall, and your wife's about to see it, and you're like, oh, gosh, she asked me to do this, and now there's a coffee stain on the wall, you know. That is welcome to my world. And that's just one, you know. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Is it true? No, I really mean it, you know. Or do the washing up, and you're exhausted, so tired, and the dishes are there, and they're dirty, and you're like, the last thing I want to do right now in the world is do the washing up. That is like more zero than I could possibly imagine. How many of you have been there before? Come on. Seriously, come on. 1,000 times, thank you. That's honesty right there. Well, get this. I walk in the church, the local church, I would never leave a piece of paper on the floor if it was on the floor. Ever. Never, ever, ever, because I see that this is my house. And that changes the revelation of serving. What happens, why people get planted in the house and serving, both of those things are extremely important. And what they do is they cultivate a heart, a posture of servanthood. Do you know what I'm saying? Now, Jesus was doing a miracle ministry, right? Miracle ministry. Was his job to wash the feet of the disciples before the meal? Was that his job, right, really? Where was he at? What was he doing? Well, he was one of the best, he probably was the best known person in the whole region, apart from maybe Pilate and the other Caesar. So really, what did he do? He said, actually, he said, the greatest among you will become your what? Servant. And so when I came to work here, Fini said, for three years, we just do the bins together. We just used to spend time kicking the bins down, pushing them down. There'd be poo, there'd be all different stuff in the bins, and we used to do it. And Fini used to just smile at me and go, isn't this the best job in the church? And it took me another year to get it. And then I was like, yeah, it really is, you know. But it's that concept that you don't do, whatever you do, you just do it unto God anyway. And it's such a privilege to be able to do that. So absolutely, when I'm talking about belonging in a prophetic community, I'm not talking about the outworking of servanthood. That's the fruit of actually belonging. Because I belong at home, I do the stuff in my house because I belong there. It's my house. When I'm here, I do the stuff because I belong here. I don't do anything. I genuinely don't do the bins because I get paid, on staff here. I do the bins because that just needs to be done. Like genuinely, you know, and that's a really good thing. An outworking of your belonging means that you just end up serving. You just put your hand up, you go, hey, is there anything we can do? The reason we do serving in this house and other houses, they do it in different time slots, is because that's when the services are. That's when the stuff gets used. That's when stuff happens. They go, yeah, you're on a Sunday morning on a cleanup or a Sunday afternoon. Well, why are you on cleanup? Because everyone's there and the house needs to be cleaned before the other people come in. Same as if you were at home and your wife or husband was at work and they said, the kids have been in the house, they've made a mess, but we've got people coming over at 5. Well, how many of you know it's your job to do the cleaning? Because someone's about to come out. It's exactly the same concept. Exactly the same concept. We've got to get out of the a negative mindset about that. But that was not necessarily about you at all. That was just does that help? So yeah, serving is totally an outworking of that. And definitely, definitely. You never ever stop doing chairs. I heard someone say this once. They said, in ministry, you will never stop lifting chairs, ever. And I know a famous minister, very famous, and I spoke to his pastor once, and I said, wow, what's this guy like at church? And he goes, first one to church, and he had the most powerful, he was one of the most well-known itinerant ministers on earth in our, and I spoke to his pastor, we spoke to him personally, he goes, what's he like? He goes, the first one in at church, comes in, and he's got family, first one in at church, and he just does, he comes in, does anything that needs to be done, sets up all the chairs in the morning, on a Sunday. And I'm like, I was completely shocked. I was like, he would be able to just literally be signing kind of product all the time. And he goes, no, he just comes in and serves the house. He says he's the most diligent servant we've got in the house. I was like, oh, God, that spoke to me so much. Never graduate from just serving in the house, you know. I don't even love that. Awesome. So there's some chairs to do it after this, just to let you know. Any other questions? Two more. Go.
Like, what happens, like, what would it be if you don't feel like you fit in church? And, like, yeah, like, I think.
Awesome. If you feel like you don't fit in church, well, that's a really big deal as well. I don't think that anyone should feel like they really fit in church because do you understand? Like, because even the concept of fitting in church, church is full of unique individuals. You should feel completely different from everybody else, but you should be able to settle in your heart. Does that make sense? So, sorry, I probably worded that wrongly, but just in terms of fitting in church, and this is not about you again, I just like to, broad questions are really, really, really fun, but a lot of the time we go, do you know what's so funny? I heard it, someone, we spend a lot of time helping people settle in churches, and they go from church to church, and they're like, yeah, I've been to 6 churches, and I'm really not, you're just not feeling peace at any of them. And I'm like, wow, what's the common denominator here? What happened at the first church you left? Our pastor was so horrible to me. Oh, really? Okay. Interesting. That's cool. And what happened at the second church? Yeah, didn't really feel, wasn't going in there. People didn't really receive me. And it's a lot of it, I did write this earlier, but a lot of it's about perception. So it's about how people perceive you. What do you want from your church? Or what are you there to give or are you there to take? Because if you're there to take, you're not going to settle because you're only going to settle when, if you go into a shop, if I go into a shop with women's pajamas. Like, why? What am I going to buy in a shop? I mean, you go in there, something like boring. I'm standing there going, why am I even in here? I don't want a pair of women's pajamas at all. I want to go to JB Hi-Fi and I want to look at all the different DVDs and Blu-rays, you know. But the reason I don't want to be there is because it's not going to give me what I think that I need. Do you hear what I'm saying? It's the same with the church. If you feel like you need to get something from the church rather than giving to a church. And I'm not saying, I'm talking about home church. I know that you can go into this in so many different levels and go, oh yeah, but God's, you've got to feel it's the right fit for you and everything else. I went to one church and then I went to this church. I'd been to another church before, but I'm saying I had a real consistency in church. Finney's only been to 2 churches in 37 years. I don't think that finding a really good church is really that difficult. To be perfectly honest, I don't think that, I know people go, oh no, but you don't understand, there's no well, you know, there's no, I feel like if you find a place that you can drink from, you stay there until the Lord says go. And when the Lord says go, he never calls you, really, really rarely, I really believe this, doesn't call you into an isolation limbo land with church. He does, he's not like that. No, you'll be out of family. Who does that? As if he's going to do that. And I hear so many people, I've been out of church 12 months, I'm just waiting for the right one. I'm like, are you kidding me? And people go, I'm just moving to, and this is not anyone here or anyone I've been speaking to in the last few months, but I'm just moving to this nation. I'm like, oh, that's so interesting. What church are you going to go to? Because for me, that would be I wouldn't even, if God said, go and live in Brazil, the first question within 5 seconds of my tongue would be, which region, which church, which pastor? Full stop, 100%. Because I know that I can't survive without local church community. I wouldn't. And if he said no church, I'll say that's not God. Get behind me. 100%. Because I know that that's not how he rolls. Do you understand? And so it's interesting. I just love people. We're learning. Does that mean that there's not cases that where people are sent to go and plant stuff? Absolutely. Gosh, that's the whole goal. We go out and we plant things. But then it's a different thing. It's, hey, you know what? I feel like I'm being pulled out of church at the moment and to spend 3 months by myself because I feel like the Lord's sending me to Uganda to plant a church. Well, that is completely different. That means God is preparing you in a place, in a season of intimacy to go and plant a church. That's a whole, do you understand? But God doesn't, I feel like God says these absolutes and then doesn't give us the next step all the time. That isn't him. He doesn't work like that. It's so bad to think, I'm not saying he doesn't give you a little step and then a little step and a little step, but he doesn't ask you to do something radical and then not tell you anything and just leave you there. That is so not fathering. That would be terrible. Imagine you go and say to your son, go and wait in the car, and we're going to go somewhere. And the son goes out there, it's 5 o'clock, goes out, misses dinner, sits in the car, sitting waiting for you, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, falls asleep in the car, still stays in the car, 6 o'clock in the morning, comes in, you're just sitting on the sofa watching TV. You go, hey, told me to go in the car. And he goes, no, that wasn't me, your sister played a joke on you, I'm sorry, I should have come out and got you. Because what it is, I know it's funny analogy, right? Why? Because father doesn't do that. He doesn't just send you and sit in the car and just wait there and I might tell you something later. Are you ready? Do you understand? He doesn't torture us. He's not a torturing God. Does he not say, go and stay in a place and remain? Absolutely. But then you know you're remaining. You're not waiting. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? So what is the word on that season? Remain. Well, what does remain mean? Remain means settle. Remain means stand. Remain means, and there's a lot in just going and standing somewhere. Rather, do you know what I'm trying to say? Anyway, okay. Anyone else? One more question. Then we go. Did that answer your question? Who was the question? Are you sure? A little bit. We can talk later about not fitting in church. Okay, cool. Does everyone feel like they're fitting in church now? Kind of. It's very good. I feel like we're in a season, and we only got a couple of minutes left. I feel like we're in a season where we're really, really learning to hear the voice of the Lord. And gone are the days where we're going, God said this, God said that, God said this, God said that, God said this. I feel like we're coming out of that. Because when we say God said something, it's going to carry so much weight. When the word of the Lord carries glory. Say God said something, it's like, gosh, God's calling me to Africa. Yeah, he is. Do you know, there's no debate around the word that God, do you understand? And so I feel like we're going to start to hear, there's a whimsical free in the spirit. There's a couple of scriptures, I had this bit, but there's a couple of scriptures that we misinterpret, and I just want to read them and then I'll close, sorry. I'll just do this instead of a question, but there's a couple of scriptures we misinterpret. The first one is that as the wind blows where it wills, and so is everyone that is born of the spirit. The wind blows where it wills, and so is everyone who is born of the spirit. It goes this way, it goes that way. You don't know where they're coming from and you don't know where they're going. You know, and so suddenly you think, okay, I've been born again. I can just go and do whatever I want as a prophetic person. I'll be here. Belinda, one day I'll be there. And I do probably do this quite a lot. But and today I'm there and you don't know where I'm going because I'm just being led by the Spirit. Well, in Romans 8, it talks about, Paul says this, not in Romans 8, but Paul says this. He says, everything is permissible for me, but not everything is beneficial. Romans 8 talks about those who are led by the Spirit are no longer what? Under the law. What does Jesus talk to? So when Jesus is talking in John 3 to, I forgot his name. I'm so sorry, I'm tired. No, it begins with an N. Nicodemus. He says what? Are you not a teacher of the law and you don't know these things? Because the law was teaching, pointing to Christ as the liberator. Do you understand? So those who are born of the Spirit are not under the law anymore. So therefore, as the Spirit moves them, they're not living according to the worldly function. They've actually been set free from that. Do you hear what I'm saying? And he's saying, surely you're a teacher of the law. You should know this. You should know what I'm talking about. But we pass it, and that's just one interpretation of that. Do you understand? So what happens is that, so he's talking about the difference between being under the law and then being born of the Spirit, being led by the Spirit. And what we do is we take something and then we go, okay, that just means I'm going to go wherever I want to do and do whatever I want to do. And that's just weird. There's another one that says, foxes have holes in the ground and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man doesn't have anywhere to lay his head. And you go, yeah, when I'm born again, I've got no church, there's nowhere for me. I'm just called out into ministry. I'm just out in the ministry world, everybody. I'm ready. Are you ready? Oh, we're in the ministry, whimsical world of the ministry, and we might land over here, or we might land over there. And so that's one. And another one is in Isaiah where it says, who will go for us? Who should we send? And we go, here I am, send me. Here I am, send me. And then he says, great. And he uses the prophet and he takes the prophet and he says, okay, I've anointed your mouth now to go and preach a particular word in into that zone. Do you know what I'm saying? And so we go to a conference, we're doing this thing, we go, okay, I'm now in the ministry zone, I'm being released, I'm moving as the Spirit, moving as the wind, and I'm going into this next season, this next stage with the Holy Spirit. And the more I learn about God, the more I see that He's about family. The more I learn about God, the more I see that He's about people settling. The more I see about God, the more I know God, the more I know He's concerned about our soul, our physical body, and our heart. Do you know what God speaks to me most of the time? How are you feeling? You feeling tired? It's not that He doesn't know. He wants me to connect with how I'm doing. Do you know what I mean? And it's like we expect this grander word. God's in the presence. You're in the presence. For 5 years, I just go in the presence. God come. I go, what nation? God, I can hear you. What nation? He's going, no, I'm just coming to hang out. Like, yeah, I'm not. Like, you know. And then I'm here. God, send me. I'm ready. Are you ready? Send me out right now. I can feel the wind of the Spirit coming right now. I'm booking a ticket. I'm booking a ticket right now. The Lord visited me. What did He say? He didn't have to say anything. I just knew. We knew. He knew. I knew. We were there. He just released me right there and there. I got commissioned. I got commissioned in the Spirit. Have you been commissioned recently? 4 angels. 5 angels visited me. I got commissioned. I'm out. I'm out in the zone. No, 10 angels. Gabriel commissioned me. Then Ezekiel came back from... He was a color witness. No, was that Joseph? One of them commissioned me, said that I got a mantle of Joseph because I was in prison. Then I came back out. But then Joseph said, Daniel told me that I had to go back in for a little while. So I went back in. And then Gabriel came and they took me back out again. Man, it's been a big week. I'm laughing because I've done it. But I'm also laughing because there are many people that go into interesting zones. Does that mean the cloud of witnesses don't speak to you? No, not at all. I've had many encounters with the cloud of witnesses. Does that mean that the angels don't speak? No, not at all. The angels love to speak to you. But what happens is that we misinterpret what God is speaking because we get so full of this grand God is speaking ministry, prophetic, especially as prophetic people. We want the big words, you know. We want the big, you know, oh, yeah, I'm a prophetic. Because really, let me be perfectly honest, and we'll close now. Let me say something completely honestly. There are people in here and you believe that you are a prophet. 100%. And you will never tell anyone, but you actually probably believe that you are a prophet. Actually, because maybe God spoke to you from Jeremiah 1 and said, before you were born, I ordained you as a prophet. And that scripture was quickened to you. And you're like, yeah, I am a prophet, but I'm never going to talk to anyone about that. And there might be some people here that you actually really feel deep in your spirit that you're an apostle. Where you read the book of Paul and you're like, oh gosh, I feel like, but I'm doing the day-to-day. And I'm just being totally real because I feel like we don't do real enough. Meet with people and there's so much beating around the bush. It's like, how are you doing? Yeah, good. Did you hear that prophetic word? I go, just shut up. Do you think you're a prophet? Yes. Okay. Well, I don't think you are. Is that right? Yes. Okay. Well, we can talk about it another day. Do you know what I'm saying? Do you understand? But how healthy is that? Oh, wow. And then suddenly he just knocked in something else. Oh, maybe I'm not. Actually, I never really wanted to be a prophet. I really like painting. Well, great. Do you think I'm an artist? Well, I dream about art all the time. Well, you're a prophetic painter. Oh, really? I thought I was going to be a prophet. Thank goodness for that. I didn't want to be a prophet. Read through the Bible. I've been thinking about that for 18 years. And I'm just like, but what I'm saying is this. I'm saying that there's too much beating around the bush and not enough vulnerability and honesty. We're in this season of I see you, I know you. You don't need to know, everyone doesn't need to know your inner workings of everything else, but stop pretending and acting in a particular way. Just be real and go, actually, I'm not saying this is you or the people in New Stream. My rebuke, is it too hard? Be honest. Okay. Be real. And do you know how I know this? I've been pastor for many years. I see people every week. We know people and we know how it works. People are too scared to even talk about stuff. I feel like I'm called into ministry full-time ministry, called. I'm a pastor, I'm called. You are called, just hang out with your mother. Your mum needs you right now. Like it's just this whole, it's overwhelming and it's not from God. This overwhelming sensation of calling. Do you hear what I'm saying? Now, if you have been ordained by Gabriel recently, come and talk to me because it is important. But just remember, if you are something, you'll do it all the time and people will recognize it. And it has to be, and this is the most crazy part of all of it, it has to be recognized at some stage by man and called out. It has to be recognized by man and called out. How do we know that? Because David was ordained, and then it was recognized by men and then called out. So there's an ordination, and then there's a release. And I think it's really important because we're talking, to prophetic people about belonging in a prophetic community, and there's many, many people that, and it, gosh, we've all, I was there for a long time. Does it mean it's all wrong? No, it doesn't mean that. But what it does mean is God is grounding us out so that we can actually go, okay, I might be called to this, but what is God calling me to do today? Yes. I'm called to Africa, 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 Africa. But I've actually got a great job right now in Kukai, and I'm going to win that girl to the Lord. Well, that's awesome. Just do that. Just take her out for coffee. Buy some cake. You know, enjoy. Enjoy Kukai. You know what I'm saying? Anyway, let's close. So we're going to do a thing. Let me just pray for you, and then we're going to just take the offering. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you that everyone sat so well through the teaching today. In the name of Jesus, I just thank you that you're bringing us up to a new level, a new season, where we're going to be free to fly, free to be vulnerable, and when we're vulnerable, we fly. So, Father, we just declare a season of soaring in Jesus' name. Father, I thank you that where there have been misfires from people when they've been administering prophetic things and it's put them on the back foot, Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you, bring healing. Father, we thank you that our identity is not tied up in gifting, but it's actually tied up in you. And Father, we thank you that we are just sons and daughters, and that's all. And that's all we need to be. And so, Father, we just thank you. We bless that. We bless every person here. And Father, I thank you that where there have been people that have struggled not to belong, Father, we thank you that you're bringing every one of us into a new season and a new depth of being able to settle and belong in the family of God. In the name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Awesome. Belinda's going to pass the bags around. It's good. Watch cars.